It took such a long time out of making movies because he read a book entitled The Hoods and he fell completely in love with the story. He wanted to make a movie, but he couldn't get the rights for it.
Having eventually secured the film rights to The Hoods, there followed a protracted period during which a team of writers, including the renowned partnership of Leo Benvenuti and Piero De Bernardi, began work to create what would eventually become Once Upon a Time in America.
We became involved with it at a late stage, but saying that we were still involved with it over a period of 12 years, I think it must have been the longest script writing process in the history of movies.
During the script writing, he was shooting the film in his mind, you know, which made things much easier, you know, when, you know, the film was actually made and shot.
Walking up and down aimlessly on the Croisette in Cannes, I see on the terrace of the Carlton Hotel an unmistakable face. Oh my God, this is Sergio Leone. Now, I did not know at that time that he was sitting on that terrace for 11 years waiting for a guy to walk over, introduce himself and say, may I write a check and finance a movie and produce it? So he was delighted. He said, sit down, have a coffee. And he told me the story frame by frame, literally on real time. I think it was 3 hours and 47 minutes. And I was seeing the movie. And I got up, I gave him a hug and said, I'm in.
They sent me the Sergio's outline for the film. The outline is 200 plus pages, the outline for a film. It's twice as long as most films. Sent it to me, and I said, fine, I like it. And he proceeded to give me a script and talk to me. It was an Italian script, meaning the description is on the left and the dialogue's on the right. The script that he gave me had the description on the left and nothing on the right throughout this entire script. And he said, fill it in. develop the characters and fill it in. So I proceeded to do so, and I wrote a draft. This is a script over 400 pages long. I wrote this draft. I brought it to Sergio in New York at that time, brought it to Sergio, and he sat down with it, and he began to read the script, and he read it, and he started to chuckle, and he started to laugh, and he was rocking and reading it and laughing, and he called one of his assistants over, and then he read it to him, and he translated it into Italian, what I'd written. Went through, read the entire script while I was sitting there, 400, laughing. And he looked at it and he said, put it down on the side and he said, this is very funny. I don't want funny. And I proceeded at that point to go on writing.
After you do the Dollars trilogy, you know, how can you ever top that? And then he managed to top it. Well, Once Upon a Time in America, and it's like, there's almost like, how far can you go?
All the people, all the crew, I think could feel that would be a great movie. I mean, that we're all making something special.
Very powerful, very in charge. I mean, you knew that this man was in charge of this movie and in charge of every single detail that was going to happen. It was very intimidating at first. Nobody on the set spoke any English, including Sergio. And he knew every look that was going to be in this film before he even shot it. He knew every moment how it was going to play out before he shot it.
I remember very specifically him looking at a page in which Noodles, the Robert De Niro character, meets Tuesday Weld in a hospital. And he looked at it and he said, I need 10 more words. And he pointed to a line, Tuesday Weld line. And I said, "It's okay. Isn't it okay the way it is?" He said, "It's fine, I need 10 more words." And I said, "Why?" And he said, "She's going to walk from here to there, and I want her to talk all the way there." He already knew what the set was going to look like. He knew how far she would walk. He knew where the camera was going to be before a set had been built, before anything had been done. And he knew he needed 10 more words to get Tuesday Weld across the room.
He had the vision, knew exactly what he wanted. He would get it every time. And yet he wasn't against being shown something completely different that we might come up with as actors, you know. So he had the best of both worlds going for him, as far as I'm concerned. You know, an extraordinary vision, the temperament and discipline and talent to bring it to fruition, and the kind of flexible ego that would allow input from people that would make things even better than he had imagined them, if that were possible. And quite frankly, it very often was not possible to make it better than he envisioned.
He would demonstrate physically absolutely everything.
He was an actor. This man was an actor, and he could act Once Upon a Time in America from start to finish, 3 hours and 45 minutes, play all the different parts and be convincing. That's how brilliant he was.
He even had explained and talked to Ennio Morricone about the music so much in advance that two-thirds of the music was recorded, not full orchestra, and playing on the set while we were shooting. It was like amazing. You go on the set and the music is playing already. It was magic.
Once we were doing a scene where Bobby gets out of prison and I'm supposed to meet him, and Sergio's on this big crane. We're down in the Bedford-Stuyvesant, or the Williamsburg section of Brooklyn. We're on the street, and Sergio says, "Oh, it's going to rain." So he's sitting on the crane waiting, because he was a big wide shot of the street, and as we come together, the crane comes down and comes right into the two of us, and Sergio wanted to start raining in the middle of the shot. So he was like trying to time the shot, you know. Like, I mean, they couldn't get rain machines in because the shot was so wide to begin with. And I thought, only Sergio Leone would wait for God, like, to have it start raining in the middle of the take, you know, and trust that when he said action, God would accommodate him by, you know, letting the clouds open up. And, you know, much to my, well, actually not surprised, but to my never-ending astonishment of working with Sergio Leone, you know, we did the take, and of course, in the middle of the take, it started raining. So there it was, you know. I said, you know, there it is.
How are you, Uncle? You're looking good. You're looking a little better. Come on. Let's get you off the streets.
Everyone has had a big consideration of him, but not only as a director, as a man. I love the thing that he used to spend his nights, I mean, his dinner with everyone. It wasn't a star, never. So we spent nights cooking in the hotel where we were staying with the technical or De Niro or whatever. I mean, it was the same thing. People he loved, people he liked to stay with.
That film was made in, what, 1982? And this is 1999. And to this day, people come to me and say, "Can I ask you a question?" I go, "I don't know whether it was me who jumped in the garbage truck or not." And Sergio's answer was, "You know, it could be you, it could not be you." And in fact, for that actual shot, we used a photo double, even though I was on the set, because Sergio wanted to be a little confusing whether it was me or not. And he said, "It's like Jimmy Hoffa. We know, but we don't know, but we know." You know, and that's the case with my character. Was he thrown in the garbage truck? Was he shot? There's one thing we know. He ain't coming to dinner tomorrow night, okay? You know what I'm saying? He's not going to be showing up, you know, for the Red Sox game next Tuesday. You know, so it doesn't make any difference, you know, because in that world, you never know, and that's sort of the point. And, I mean, to make a movie that long that rests on that kind of puzzle and then leave the audience consciously so frustrated, and yet challenging them to admit that they know what the answer is, even if they think they don't know, is just astounding. I mean, the level of difficulty that he tried to achieve in that movie, that he aspired to, and did achieve, it's extraordinary. I mean, I think it's one of the greatest movies ever made, and forget that I'm in it. I mean, I wish I weren't in it so I could say it more fervently. I mean, it's just, it's an absolute masterwork of cinema. There's no doubt about it.
After the first screening in the Barberini cinema here in Rome, the audience was slowly coming out, full up with the movie. After 3 hours and 40 minutes of images, they were completely satisfied, as if they had eaten a big meal. Leone was standing on the opposite side of the pavement to watch the audience's faces as they left. A man recognized him. I was there. He says, Mr. Leone, many compliments. It was a really enjoyable 3 hours. But tell me, what was the significance of Robert De Niro's smile at the end, looked at from above? You must know, says Leone, the movie starts in an opium den, and he smokes opium in the beginning, and he ends up back there. Oh, who knows? Maybe the movie is a kind of... And before he had a chance to finish, the man said, please, Mr. Leone, don't tell me this. And he left, because he didn't want to know that maybe, just maybe, the story of the film was a big nightmare or a dream under opium.
A few weeks before it came out, they decided to use the assistant editor of Police Academy or something, you know, to chop it all up and tell it in linear fashion, which is the whole point of how the story is made, was that it's not in linear fashion. I mean, it was the telling of the story that made it such an extraordinary film. And I remember it was a huge disappointment to me and so on, and Sergio had been so great, and, you know, when we were at the Cannes Film Festival, where it had its world premiere, you know, the reviews and the response was so astounding. I remember one article that said, headline said, you know, filmmakers cast your films into the sea. Leone is here with Once Upon, you know, it was like, because it was like that. I mean, it just got this 15-minute standing ovation and then was butchered, and I thought it must have broken his heart.
Today what I would have done, I would have opened it in a couple of theaters, start word of mouth going. I was really truly naive. I did not know a lot of things.
There are three versions released in the United States that I know of, and then there's a much longer version, which is the definitive version that's never been shown in the United States. The first two versions, which were the initially released ones, which got very, very bad reviews, were not only shortened, but the time sequence was changed. The film is a series of flashbacks to two different periods, plus the present, which is 1968 in the film. And by going back and trying to arrange it chronologically, which is what happened when the film was released initially, it doesn't make any sense.
Imagine how horribly unorganized the release was, to a point that they forgot to enter Ennio Morricone's music to register. Or Ennio would have gotten Academy Award for sure. It's probably the best score in the history of the movie business, by far.
Sheila Benson at the time voted it the worst movie of the year, and then 8 years later voted it the best movie of the decade, which I thought was really interesting. The best movie being Sergio's own cut, the worst movie being, of course, the cut that the studio released.
The last time I saw Serge was in Paris, actually. It was we had lunch at, I don't know, someplace. And he was telling me about how they had ruined his Once Upon a Time in America. How they made him cut a lot out, you know, they'd cut the time out, and you know, and really, you know, really. And he was really sad about that. You know, he said, "I spend a lot of time in making a nice movie, and they take all the essence out." And I said, "Well, you can put it back in, man. Put it back in."
The intensity of the production schedule on Once Upon a Time in America took a severe toll on Leone's health, and he was diagnosed with a severe heart disease.
The only alternative was a transplant. He knew it, and he would have never accepted that. He was just starting a new movie, and that would have given him big problems.
Thank you. His concentration was so intense on what he was doing, and all his energy went into that project. As he said, I lose 5 years of my life on every picture, and I saw it happening. I mean, him putting an hour in is like most directors putting 4 hours in.
When I first started filmmaking, there was all these like little like, you know, filmmaking expressions I didn't know as in anything. And so I would just kind of make up stuff, and that became the expression as far as the term was concerned on the set. And the biggest one was I always knew how to say an extreme close up. But again, I always like, I'm thinking in terms of the effect I want. And so I'd say, I want a Sergio Leone. Okay, so give me a Sergio Leone here. And when I'm saying Sergio Leone, that's more important than saying an extreme close up, because anybody can give you an extreme close up. When I say, give me a Sergio Leone, I'm implying the feel I wanted it. It's just not an extreme close up, it's not just a frame.
He interpreted his movies in a very responsible and creative manner. The greatest regret is that he could have stayed alive. I don't know how far he would have gone. It is a great loss, not only for Italian cinema, but for cinema worldwide.
You know, on my deathbed, you know, and somebody says, you know, what was the greatest artistic experience you ever had? It was working with Sergio Leone. There's no doubt about it. It was the Everest of my life, you know. And I never got a chance to tell him that because I was too young or confused or too shy to call him up and sort of say it, you know, and so on. And one of the reasons I wanted to do this interview is to sort of say it so somebody in the world could hear it.
I know a lot of people when they're interviewed will say something like, that was one of the most exciting periods of my life, the most exciting things I ever worked. What do you mean the most? That includes a lot of other things then too. No, that was the most exciting creative experience I've ever had.
Many times when I'm shooting a movie with a director, you know, he's putting the camera and I think of Sergio and I say, Sergio, unfortunately, it's not you here today.
I wish you were still around.